And in keeping with our focus on our cities, today we are looking at the use of EVs, electric cars. Are they going to be a revolution in India? Is it going to transform our lives? Gul Panag with me has decided to show me what an EV is all about, because I've never driven one. I've never, in fact, even sat on one. So that's a bit of a confession. But Gul has been championing this cause for a very long time. And she's going to tell us a little bit of what it's all about, shall we?
Yes.
Gul, how many years have you been driving these electric cars?
3 years in December.
3 years in December. And you've had several, right?
So I've had the two-door to begin with.
Yep.
And then I got a four-door.
Right.
And now I'm getting the fully loaded four-door with a bigger engine capacity. I mean, so bigger battery capacity.
Why did you convert to EVs?
I think the fact that it's a very fun car to drive.
Yep.
Goes without saying. I mean, that was my motivation. I tested this car as a jury member long back.
Yep.
And I enjoyed it, and I figured that if this can be my daily commuter,
yeah,
it would be really good. And that's why I actually got it. I mean, it's quick, it's compact, it's perfect for local commute.
So charging, how easy or how difficult is that?
It depends. So I'll try and draw an analogy to when we first got mobile phones.
Yeah.
We were responsible for charging our own phones.
Yep.
We didn't bank on other people's charging points or,
yep,
or power banks.
Yep.
We left the house fully charged.
Right.
So that's how we are. We are looking at it in terms of time frame space.
Right.
So the early days of EV.
Yeah.
I charge the car about twice a week.
Yeah.
And I have a stilt parking.
Yep.
In my building in Bombay.
Right.
I've run a line from my meter.
Yeah.
A normal line.
Yeah.
And just put a plug point, a 15 amp plug point, and then charge the car there.
And how long does the charge last? How long can you drive these
cars? Depending on the battery capacity, it takes between 3 to 4 hours to charge.
But Gul, the problem a lot of people say is that it's a bit expensive.
Sure.
The initial cost,
sure,
of buying an electric,
sure,
car is expensive.
It is. It is an expensive piece of technology, and these are early days.
Right.
So yes, it is probably slightly expensive. There is a subsidy which still makes,
yeah,
it slightly expensive, because,
yeah,
technology is in its nascent stages when it comes to an electric car, because the battery is what's the single largest cost, of a car like this.
Yeah.
Having said that, the day-to-day running cost is a lot cheaper.
In fact, what you were telling me was interesting. A 1.5 ton AC.
Yes.
So if you run that for 3 hours a day, then that's the amount, that's the cost, equivalent cost.
About 10 units.
So 10 units, yeah.
In fact, you could draw a parallel now that winter is coming in Delhi.
Yeah.
The heaters you run.
Yeah.
So this car takes about 10 to 11 units to charge.
Right.
And that's the consumption.
So and approximately 10 rupees a unit.
If,
right?
A
if one goes, if it's a progressive lab, if one goes with that.
Yes.
And, so it comes to.
And cheaper even if you're in a different city.
Right. So it's 100 rupees a charge.
100 rupees a charge, 10 units 10 rupees a unit.
Right.
And one charge would take you to about, depending on the range, I mean,
we can go left here.
Okay.
Yeah.
I currently have the 120 kilometer
right
range option. I'm
right
upgrading to the 140 kilometer range.
Okay.
So my present charge gives me about 85, 90.
Right.
Which is sufficient, because I was reading a report in a magazine.
Yeah.
Which said that daily average commute in India,
uh-huh,
is about 25 to 30 kilometers.
Okay.
Average commute. I mean, of course, there will be people who will drive, say, Delhi to Gurgaon,
yeah,
Noida to Gurgaon.
Yeah.
But those are not the average commuters.
Uh-huh.
The average commuter is doing between 25 and 30 kilometers. And if that is your average commute, this is the perfect answer.
So basically, once the prices of these cars come down, and that I think is also going to be linked to the subsidy the government actually gives,
right,
then it's going to be a lot more affordable.
So
and that's key, the subsidy, right?
There's already a subsidy. Unfortunately, there has been a bit of a back forth as far as the subsidy issue is concerned.
Yeah.
So if I were an OEM manufacturer, what I'd look for is stability in policy. I'd like to see a 15-year plan.
Yeah.
So that I can decide my outlays from an investment perspective,
right,
on how I can do this.
Okay.
So the fundamental issue here is the policy needs to be a long-term policy,
yeah,
minimum 15 years.
Okay. Now, the other thing is, charging points. Now, the argument against electric cars is that most people don't have parking inside their houses. So where on the roads can they be expected to charge?
That is an issue, there's no doubt about it. On the charging point front, you know, again, I charge my own car before I leave the house. Just like you put your mobile phone on charge every night, you have to charge your car every night or every 2 days or whenever it is that you, depending on your usage. Now, on the public infrastructure, as far as charging is concerned, there again, there needs to be policy clarity.
Okay.
So today, the government is the only seller of power and electricity.
Right.
As time goes by, we would need other players to enter the market.
Yeah.
And that can only perhaps happen through a public-private partnership model. You can't expect private players to invest in charging stations when they can't sell power.
Right.
So that part needs to be cleared out. For example, the City of London gives free power. Now that's it's a rich country. I mean, they give a £4,500.
But that's something that governments need to be doing. That's
governments
what you're trying to say.
Governments don't necessarily have to do that. If they can find a billing mechanism, private players can offer the same service.
Right.
But it fundamentally comes down to the sale of power.
Right.
Currently, only the government can sell power. Therefore, only the government can set up charging stations.
Yeah. No, and what about the other concern? Safety standards. Are electric cars in India, which are some of the least expensive electric cars in the world, in fact, the least expensive, some of the models, are they necessarily as safe as they should be?
So, Vishnu, every car on this road needs to comply with the Central Motor Vehicle Act stipulated safety norms.
Yeah.
Right? It's as safe or as safe as you want it to be compared to any other car on the Indian road in its segment.
Okay. 2030, that's what this government says needs to be a target. And if we don't have a target, then nothing is going to happen. Realistically, do you actually see that happening? Are people going to say, okay, I'm going to buy an electric car, I'm going to get rid of my diesel, I'm going to get rid of my big horsepower engines, you know, and I'm going to move to something that doesn't sound, I mean, it's unreal, you know, I mean, it's like...
It's completely sad.
Yeah.
2030 is a very ambitious plan, but with a robust and thought out policy framework in place, it is achievable in segments.
Right.
So, even if we end up achieving at a passenger segment 40%, we will still be the largest EV nation, you know, maybe at par with the US.
Right.
Or even some places in Europe.
Right.
Even if we achieve 40% of that target, remember, we buy 7 million cars in India.
Right.
Now, that's on the passenger segment front.
Right.
But in segments like buses and two-wheelers, it's a 100% achievable target because the leap in two-wheelers is much quicker to make.
So buses, you believe, should become all electric. What about trucks? I mean, the technology exists, but implementation in India, difficult.
I think over time, it is possible. These are early days. And I feel that trucks will probably be the last to comply.
Yeah.
Simply because of the availability of an alternative in the electric
You also
space.
Need much more powerful engines with a lot of torque.
Those are under development, Vishnu. 2030 is far away, but yet not that far away when it comes to trying to plan for it.
Sure.
But
we'll take the next left.
I see full compliance possible in buses.
Yeah.
And I see full compliance possible in two-wheelers.
Yeah.
By 2030, and about 35 to 40 percent compliance as far as personal vehicles are concerned. But here's the thing: I think the government has shown tremendous faith in its own plan with the EESL tender. 10,000 electric vehicles, the largest electric
for the government
tender in the world. And I think that's where the government shows how serious it is with its own commitment. One. Two, what the government can definitely do is mandate wherever it can control state governments, which will now, if it has its way, will be almost in 21 states.
Yeah.
Mandate public transport be all electric.
Yeah.
Buses be all electric.
Yeah.
All government official vehicles be electric.
Yeah.
And it can further incentivize taxi operators and fleet operators by saying a certain percentage of your fleet needs to be electric. So those are regulatory powers that the government has and it can enforce.
So the other thing which I found quite interesting, you were telling me, is that if 40% of of what we are trying to achieve is actually achieved, then we would have the largest EV hub in the world in 2030.
We would be
more electric cars in India. We'd be on par with
America. Yes.
Right. So that's incredible to think that is actually something that we should really be gunning for. It has to be infrastructure. It has to be charging points.
Yes.
Costs will come down if numbers increase. as battery technology increases, right? It improves, becomes more efficient.
It's also a health argument, Vishnu. I mean, which is in fact
the most important argument
today, since we're in Delhi.
Yeah.
The average human being, you know, consumes three and a half plates of food,
right?
2 to 3 to 4 liters of water, and 7 to 8 liters of air per minute. 11,000 liters of air by volume is what we are consuming.
Right.
And given the density of population here, and given the pollution levels, the particulate matter in our air, we are breathing 11,000 liters of bad air.
Yeah.
We've got to fix that.
And
there's no two ways about it. I mean, that's a disaster waiting to happen. As more and more vehicles are taken off the road, especially where, like I'm saying again, where the government can, it's green.
Yeah.
And you can see how quickly it moves if it's in boost.
Yeah, so it's instant acceleration.
It is. It's great fun to drive. It's,
people think that electric cars are weak and they aren't powerful, but it's
try and race with somebody and see if we'll
Well,
find
in Delhi, if we race, then you know the odds are not very good as far as our longevity is concerned.
But yes, it's
okay, we're
going
to have to take a U-turn over here. This is a bit. And so let's see how sharply it can turn.
It's got a very tiny turning radius. And here we are.
Yeah. So that's way easier than what I can achieve in my car, and we just go in
compact,
left.
Yeah. It's fun. I think the best argument is it's fun to drive.
Right.
And it's very compact. It allows you to park wherever you want.
Yeah.
Without too much effort. And I think that to me is the best argument. And of course, while you're doing that, you're doing your little bit to save the environment.
Right.
The last piece that I think is relevant to mention is a lot of the naysayers say that this is ultimately being charged from electricity produced by hydrocarbons.
That's true.
Which is true today. But given the government's ambitious plan, we're going to add close to 100 megawatts of solar power by 2022, making us the largest solar power producing nation in the world.
And
another 75 gigawatts of renewable energy have already been announced.
Right.
So in the next 7 to 8 years, 50% of our power is going to be from renewable sources.
So it all has to come together. This is one part of the jigsaw puzzle.
It is.
Everything has to be clean, for it to truly work. Gul, it's been fantastic talking to you, as always.
Thank you.
Next time, Gul and I are going to be flying on a plane somewhere because she's a pilot as well. That's another area of interest. But I think the message that Gul Panag sends is absolutely essential. We need to start thinking about this. Because if we don't start thinking about this, our behavior won't change. Perceptions won't change. Ultimately, for electric cars, it's a perception battle. Will that battle be won?